you're familiar with paleontology discussions online, you may have seen a lot of talk discussing Kronosaurus recently. And some people saying that it's now a nomen dubium, and other people saying that it's not. And sometimes even the same people saying this. And there's a lot of reason for this, because the paper that actually led to this discussion is a little bit silly in how it deals with some of these issues. But first, if you're not familiar with some of these terms, a nomen dubium just means that it's a dubious name for an animal. And this is regarding scientific names, where essentially the scientific name doesn't really have a lot of use. So for example, in the dinosaur Troodon, Troodon is known only from teeth, and in general it's not used that much anymore because these teeth really aren't diagnostic. You can't tell specifically what animal it came from. So Troodon really isn't used as a name that much anymore. And as for this paper itself, it was actually looking at pliosaurs, which aren't dinosaurs, but are large marine reptiles that were very dominant during the late Jurassic and the early Cretaceous. And they were like plesiosaurs, but with much shorter necks. And this paper was specifically looking at the genus Kronosaurus and a few different specimens that have been assigned to that genus. And there's actually a few of these, some of them coming from Colombia, and then others coming from Australia, from both the Aptian and the Albian time periods of the Cretaceous. So essentially, the Cretaceous is one time period, and then it's broken down into these stages. The Albian and the Aptian are two of those stages. And some of these are assigned to be Kronosaurus still, but most of them aren't. Specifically, they state that the Albian fossil of Kronosaurus is the only one that can justly be assigned as Kronosaurus, because it's very partial and it's not really that usable as a diagnostic tool to compare to other animals. And that, to be fair, does make some sense. However, there's other issues that I'll be getting into, specifically concerning the Aptian Kronosaurus and essentially why they should not have been given a new name like they were in this paper. The Colombian ones, though, do seem very distinct, and so they were given a new name, and I think that's a perfectly reasonable assessment. Named Monkyrosaurus boyacensis, the Colombian fossils are actually pretty well complete, so it does make a lot of sense that they're actually able to compare these animals to the Harvard specimens of Kronosaurus that are originally from Australia, specifically the Aptian of Australia, and make this assessment that it is a different animal. Meanwhile, they named the Aptian fossils from Australia originally, but at the Museum of Harvard, Iectus longmani, after Longman, the first person who actually found the original Kronosaurus fossil from the Albian. Now, these Aptian fossils are more complete, and so it does make at least some sense to give them a new name, although there is still an issue with that, because you can do what's called proposing a neotype. And that means the holotype is the first one. So that Albian fossil is the holotype of Kronosaurus, which, as I mentioned, it's very partial and not really usable as a diagnostic for comparing to other specimens. That said, these Aptian specimens have been called Kronosaurus for a very, very long time. There's no reason not to just move the name to these specimens and use one of these specimens as a new holotype, essentially, and that's called the neotype. And this has happened for other groups. One of the most famous discussions with this is involving the new Spinosaurus fossil, where some people are saying we should just use that as a neotype of Spinosaurus, because the holotype was destroyed during World War II during a bombing raid in Munich. Now, this doesn't mean that this research is bad in any way. In fact, Monkyrosaurus does seem entirely valid, and it makes a lot of sense to have it as its own genus. It's just that changing the other fossils to Iectus doesn't make sense because there's already been a lot written about them as Kronosaurus. And since they've already been described as Kronosaurus in a lot of different papers, further research on these animals is going to have to account for that and mention, oh yeah, these ones that cite Kronosaurus, it's not actually Kronosaurus anymore, whereas we can just move the Kronosaurus genus to those specimens. It just streamlines the entire scientific process to a greater degree than trying to name it. And it seems honestly like some of the authors may have just been trying to name it to, oh, hey, we need to fix this taxonomy, without actually addressing the underlying problems. And this issue isn't limited to just pliosaurs, because the dinosaur lab at the Natural History Museum in London actually had a specific tweet where they were saying they had multiple papers that they were reviewing for peer review for entry into a journal. And the authors for many of these papers never actually went to go see the fossils, they just went, there's a taxonomic issue where we could name something, so we're going to. Rather than actually looking at the underlying issues and past research that's been done on these animals to try and understand why exactly they should or shouldn't actually name something and give it a new genus, and how that might actually complicate some parts of the science more than is necessary.